come nasce una carta di Keyforge o un TCG come Magic the Gathering, Pokémon, Flesh and Blood e ogni altro gioco di carte di formato standard? Come viene partorita l'idea che poi dovrà essere traslata dal piano immaginario a quello della realtà? E qual è il processo di creazione che porta il prodotto finito tra le mani di un appassionato per essere utilizzato in partita? Nel video di oggi troverete la risposta a queste domande. Signori, bentornati sul canale con il nostro consueto appuntamento settimanale. Ultimamente mi sono sempre più chiesto quale fosse stato il viaggio di una singola carta che da una semplice ipotesi di progetto è arrivata infine sui tavoli da gioco. A dirvi la verità, è sempre stata una mia curiosità e non felice di rimanere con il dubbio, ho iniziato a cercare alla fonte tentando di avere contatti con coloro che sono impiegati in prima linea, ovvero gli artisti che grazie alle loro opere danno un volto ad ogni elemento giocato. Ho quindi iniziato a mandare messaggi privati, mail e quant'altro, ma senza successo. Alla fine, arrivato proprio a pensare che non sarei mai giunto ad una conclusione, ho deciso di giocarmi l'ultima carta puntando al vertice. Ed è proprio in quest'ultimo disperato tentativo che ho ricevuto risposta. Ultimamente la FFG ha assunto un nuovo art director che ha prestato il suo talento in diverse carte iconiche di Keyforge. Prima di iniziare, piccole informazioni di servizio. Se tra voi forgiatori si nascondono anche dei duellanti, allora non potrete perdervi il nuovo Battle Box Alleanza della Luce vs Armata del Caos, prodotto di Yugi in esclusiva solo su Fantasia Store, dove potrete trovare, oltre alle 8 buste di espansione, tutte in prima edizione, anche le versioni oversize di due delle carte che hanno fatto la storia del meta iniziale del gioco, andando a formare il motore dei mazzi Caos. Sto parlando del glorioso soldato nero, emissario dell'inizio, e di una delle mie carte preferite in assoluto, ovvero il drago imperatore del Caos, ambasciatore della fine. Vi lascerò in descrizione il link all'articolo per avere maggiori informazioni al riguardo. Inoltre ringrazio di cuore il tandem Irene Luna Chiara e suo fratello Marco per aver svolto, come sempre, un lavoro eccezionale di traduzione. Infine, per chi ascolta in italiano e non mastica bene l'inglese, potrete attivare i sottotitoli per comprendere appieno le risposte fornite in questa intervista. Ed ora scopriamo assieme come nasce una carta di Keyforge e altri TCG attraverso 8 semplici domande poste ad uno degli artisti più in vista del settore, che ci fornirà la sua personale versione dei fatti attraverso l'esperienza che ha accumulato durante gli anni di attività. Ho infatti l'onore di avere qui, ospite sul canale, niente meno che Balan Shi, l'art director della FFG. Benvenuto!
Hi, my name is Steve Hamilton and I'm an art director with Fantasy Flight Games and a Keyforge card artist since Call of the Archons with 35 published card illustrations.
La prima domanda che vorrei farti è la seguente. Come hai fatto ad essere stato contattato dalla FFG? Raccontaci la tua esperienza.
I first started freelancing back in 2010 after graduating college with a degree in illustration. It took me about 4 years to get FFG's attention though. I was talking with another artist I'd met on Facebook, Diego Gisbert Jordans, who was working with them at the time. I mentioned to him that I was looking for better opportunities and the chance to work with Fantasy Flight. He took a look at my portfolio and he said he'd reach out to them on my behalf, and a few weeks later I get my first invite for a commission on Android Netrunner, and that's where things went from there. All told, I've worked on Android, Arkham, X-Wing, Armada, Destiny, and of course Keyforge during 7 years of freelancing for the company. And then last summer I started working as an art director, and I've really been enjoying the change of direction. They had an open position which I applied for, and I was thankfully invited on full time. It's been a really great experience so far, being on the other side of the curtain and getting a better understanding of the whole process altogether of developing art for board and card games.
Quando la FFG ti chiede di disegnare un personaggio come Cyberclone, un'azione come Flotta da Battaglia, che mi sono divertito a ricreare foil, una miglioria come Dangol Schermante o un artefatto come Curia Sauriana, su cosa ti basi per la realizzazione?
Well, when I'm developing any illustration for Fantasy Flight, I'm provided with a style guide in order to make sure that what I create fits within the visual designs of that intellectual property. In the case of Keyforge, we're provided with different style guides for each of the main houses in the game, depending on which factions we're working on cards for. So if I have Shadows, Logos, and Bravnar, those are the only style guides that I will be getting, unless a card has characters from another house in it as well. Those are basically the visual Bibles for each house, detailing characters, vehicles, environments, and items to use as reference and inspiration. Starting out, there was not a lot to go on other than some exploratory work and concepts that they had developed before Call of the Archons. But as the game matured, those style guides became a lot more extensive and useful to work from. And I have the pleasure of having several pieces in those style guides, which was always fun to see when working as an artist, especially in the Mars style guide. Thankfully, though, in a lot of respects, there's quite a bit of leeway in terms of how I designed things, so long as it looked like it belonged to that house. That's not always the case, especially in games with licensed IPs like Star Wars, where you have to be very careful to make sure everything is consistent with existing material, everything matches perfectly. So having the freedom to be as bright and colorful as I wanted to be was also a lot of fun, since I tend to work with highly saturated colors anyway, and yeah, not having to be too slavish to existing designs was also enjoyable.
Immagino tu le conosca in anticipo, l'effetto della carta stessa e l'eventuale testo che cita una frase detta da qualche personaggio presente nel gioco. Se così fosse, quanto influiscono sull'aspetto finale dell'opera?
Actually, I don't know a lot about the cards when I receive the assignments. We have zero information about what the card does, only the name of the card, the type of card, the house, and a description of the artwork they want on it. I always found that a little frustrating since I would have loved to know what certain cards did, especially if I was working on a high-powered chase card so I could make sure it was perfect. But part of that stems from them making changes to the card abilities or even changing entire cards while it's still in the design phase of things. And to some degree, to keep things under wraps. Most artists don't often play the games they work on, so that information would not have been necessary for them. But I would have loved to have known. They just didn't really have any pipeline for giving me that information or any reason to.
Quanti schizzi realizzi per crearti in mente un prototipo finito di disegno?
I usually create about 3 sketches per illustration, sometimes fewer if I'm pressed for time. I always like to present my art directors with a good range of options for each illustration. I'm finding as an art director that not every artist does that actually. But one of my favorite parts of the creative process is getting those initial descriptions of the illustrations I've been assigned and the very first thoughts that come through my head when I read them. Sometimes I can see it right away, other times I need to play with it a little. Sometimes I have no clue what to do, so I just try to approach it from as many useful directions as possible. And I actually found out that I had been pegged as a problem solver, which is both a good and a bad thing, I guess. It means I'm always in demand, but it also means I get some really hard pieces to paint. I started noticing it as time went on. They kept giving me more and more challenging compositions to work on. And then when I finally got hired as an art director and I asked the team about it, they laughed and they admitted that if they found a card that was hard to figure out how to create art from, they would oftentimes give it to me. The most memorable example would be Portal, which had a brief along the lines of, "A portal opens in the sky above a Star Alliance city, pouring out a wide range of sea creatures, including a whale-like creature that is lying on the ground, looking surprised next to a bowl of petunias. I read that and I thought, oh, come on, they're doing it on purpose now. There's no way to do this. Thankfully, I figured it out, but after that, I made a point of saying now and then, I don't mind doing the hard work. Just remember to throw me a few easy pieces in there, too. I would appreciate it.
Seguendo il filone dell'ultima domanda, quando proponi i primi risultati, sono sempre accettati così come sono o devono passare attraverso una serie di step che inevitabilmente ti fanno nuovamente mettere mano sul disegno per modificarlo a seconda delle esigenze della casa madre?
So, after I've delivered the sketches, I wait for the art director team to review them and decide which sketch they would like me to proceed with. When I get that feedback, along with any notes they might have for me, I am free to proceed to the work in progress stage or the WIP stage. Every artist has a different workflow, but for most of my pieces, I set aside the initial sketch and begin working on creating the 3D assets that I will use to create the scene. This is a major part of the commercial workflow for a lot of artists because it saves times and it opens up a lot of creative possibilities that are very time consuming when working in just 2D. So I'll build the scenes and the props, the items, any hard surface elements, and oftentimes base models for the characters themselves in order to get the lighting and proportions right. I'll render these out and I'll integrate them into the initial sketch and start painting over the 3D elements. So about an hour or two into this stage, I'll send the WIP, the work in progress update, to the art directors for their review to make sure everything is looking good to them. So at this point, they can't really request any major changes to the scene. The development and review process is like a funnel. All the major changes should be caught in the sketch stage, and the WIP should not have any dramatic adjustments made unless absolutely necessary. But if the lighting isn't right in a certain area, or if there's something important I'm missing, if something's not really popping or visible, they'll make a point of pointing that out to me. And it is really helpful to get an extra set of eyes looking at these and not just trying to figure it out myself what's going on. Because you can get blinded sometimes to the problems if you're working on it for a long time, you just can't even see them anymore, and then someone else can spot it right away. So after they reviewed the WIP, I move ahead to the final version of that illustration and I add any other 3D elements that I might need. I paint over everything, making further adjustments, particularly painting the things that are difficult to model, and any final visual effects over the top of everything. And when working with high volumes of art, there's very little time to make everything perfect, so I have to be pretty strategic about how I spend my time. So when everything's done, I send it in, and if necessary, they'll ask me to make some small minor changes, though thankfully they usually approve of it at that point.
Quando il tuo lavoro viene finalmente accettato, ti rendono partecipe del processo di creazione della carta? Forza, armatura, casa di appartenenza e quant'altro?
Well, kind of in line with what I said before, the artists know nothing about the abilities of the cards, and we can't really offer any input on what the cards do. Even as an art director working internally in the company, I have no say in how the design and the gameplay mechanics work unless I'm participating in internal testing groups, which is not as often as I'd like. The game designers are the specialists who are trained to do that, and as much as I'd love to design a few cards, it might be a while until I'm given the opportunity to do that.
Parliamo ora del tuo stile. Il tratto che utilizzi è inconfondibile. Cosa ti ha portato ad evolvere la tua tecnica fino ad arrivare a dove sei ora?
Well, I've always been drawn towards bright and saturated colors in my art, and for me, Keyforge is a great way to explore that interest to the best of my ability. I remember getting the first style guides when I was being brought onto the project, and they were saying, just be as bright and colorful as you want. I said, yeah, that's perfect for me. And a lot of the improvement that I've known over time has just been a result of the hours that I've put in. A big part of creating art is the ability to recognize and solve problems, as that's basically what artists do over and over again until the problems are gone or hard to see. The more practice that you have with that, the more you're able to optimize your own artwork. I have a few signature techniques that I use a lot in my artwork and some secret techniques, which I keep to myself. But to be honest, few artists will tell you that they're happy with the skill level that they're at. There's always another mountain to climb, always other ways to improve, and that process really never ends for an artist.
Un'ultima domanda. Il tuo disegno è unicamente digitale o crei qualche idea prima su carta per poi trasferire tutto su tavoletta?
I do work 100% digital using a Wacom Intuos 3 tablet, Photoshop CS6, and Blender. I do occasionally doodle on paper, but digital media is much quicker and more forgiving than traditional. There are very few artists that work traditionally in this industry, as we need to be able to create a lot of illustrations in a short amount of time. That being said, I'd love to learn how to paint traditionally some days. It's a much more relaxing experience, but for now, I'm sticking to working digitally.
Steve, ti ringrazio infinitamente per esserti prestato a questa intervista, per averci donato in esclusiva l'opera d'arte che abbiamo visto in questo video e per aver risposto in maniera chiara e concisa ad ogni domanda. Non vedo l'ora personalmente di osservare altre tue creazioni che ci mostreranno ancora più nel dettaglio il fantastico e variegato mondo qual è il crogiolo.
Yeah, thank you for having me. It was a pleasure, and I want to thank the KeyForge community in Italy, which has always been very kind and supportive to me over the past few years. You guys are awesome. Your energy and passion for the game is inspiring, and I can't wait to see what the future holds.
Grazie ancora a te per la disponibilità. Concludendo, ci sono molti easter egg in KeyForge. Ad esempio, avevate colto la menzione alla guida galattica per autostoppisti di Douglas Adams nella carta Varqueo, dove sono presenti sia il capodoglio che il vaso di petunie? Personalmente non ci avevo mai fatto caso prima di questa intervista. Magari un giorno, chissà, scopriremo assieme tutte le varie citazioni che saranno presenti sulle carte del nostro amato gioco di mazzi, unici al mondo, attraverso un video dedicato. E voi, eravate a conoscenza di questi retroscena che ha gentilmente condiviso con l'intera community Balance attraverso la sua esperienza? Fatemelo, come sempre, sapere nei commenti. Mi auguro che questo video sia stato di vostro gradimento. Prima di salutarci, vi invito ad iscrivervi al canale, attivare la campanella per non farvi sfuggire la pubblicazione dei nuovi video, lasciare un like e commentare o condividere questo contenuto con i vostri amici. In più, in descrizione, potrete trovare la wiki e la pagina di KeyForge Italia con tutte le carte aggiornate ad ondata oscura, che potranno tornarvi utili quando durante una partita verrà qualche dubbio sul come risolvere alcuni effetti. Per ogni carta, infatti, ci sarà una sezione dedicata dove troverete le risposte che cercate. Vi ringrazio per essere stati in mia compagnia. Noi ci vediamo al prossimo video.